Continuing with the lesson Dual Nature of Matter and Radiation. In the first video, that is part 1, you have studied the details of the phenomena of photoelectric effect. Now let's see some applications of this phenomena. First important point which we get from photoelectric effect is it establishes particle nature of light or radiations. We have seen that wave theory fails to explain the phenomena of photoelectric effect. Einstein could explain it satisfactorily by considering the quantum nature of radiations, where the light is considered to consist of particles or bundles or packets of energy h nu each. The effect is also used to determine the value of Planck's constant. Recall we had a graph between stopping potential and frequency, and according to the equation EV naught equal to h nu minus nu naught given by Einstein, if we see this graph and take two convenient points on this graph, you can write EV1 equal to h into nu 1 minus nu naught, that is for frequency nu 1. Similarly, for frequency nu 2, you can write EV2 is equal to h nu 2 minus nu naught. Subtracting the equations, you get EV2 minus V1 equal to h nu 2 minus nu 1. This is simple mathematics which will give you the expression for h. The effect can also be used to determine the work function for a given metal. We have this frequency nu naught called threshold frequency, and we can use this relation W naught is equal to h nu naught to get the work function of a metal. Another important application is photocell, which is used to convert light energy to electrical energy. In addition, this photocell finds a large number of applications in automation. It is used in solar panels, it is used in calculators, the photo run or solar run watches, etc. And it finds a number of other applications in automation industry. Now coming to the photon and its properties. The photon is a quanta or a bundle or a packet of energy. Some of the characteristics of the photon are: all photons travel at 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second, which is speed of light, in free space or vacuum. Every photon has a definite energy as long as it is shot from a particular monochromatic source. E equal to h nu, the energy of a photon depends on its frequency, hc by lambda. When a photon enters from one medium to another, its frequency does not change. Frequency is a fundamental property of the photon and always remains the same. The speed of a photon changes when it travels from one medium to another due to change in wavelength of the radiation. Since a photon is energy in transit, it has zero rest mass. We cannot conceive a photon which is at rest, so it has zero rest mass. However, according to the equation mc square equal to h nu, energy equal to energy, it has an equivalent mass given by m equal to h nu over c square. The linear momentum of photon is given by p equal to h by lambda, because p is mc, and then you can use this equation mc equal to h nu by c or h by lambda. A photon is electrically neutral and hence it is not affected by electric or magnetic fields. These fields fail to deflect a photon from its path. The intensity of light depends on number of photons. Larger the number of photons, more is the intensity of the light emitted by a source. Having studied photoelectric effect and properties of the photon, we are now in a position to talk about the dual nature of light or radiation. We know that light is a form of energy and it behaves both as waves as well as particle. Waves in the phenomena of interference, diffraction and polarization. It behaves as particles in phenomena of photoelectric effect. Because we have seen this is a phenomena which cannot be explained on the basis of wave theory. So the radiation or light or energy has dualistic nature, acting both as particles as well as waves. Now, de Broglie put forward a hypothesis of dual nature of matter or matter waves. He hypothesized that energy and matter are interconvertible. Energy can be changed to matter and matter can be changed to energy. The two are related by Einstein's equation E is equal to mc square. So, energy and matter must show identical behavior. As energy, that is light, shows double character, particle character as well as wave character. So, de Broglie suggested that particles should also behave as waves. The waves associated with particles or matter were called de Broglie waves. The wavelength of de Broglie waves was calculated as under. We know that for a photon, energy is given by E equal to h nu or mc square, where m is equivalent mass of the photon. The momentum associated with photon, which also talks about its particle character, is given by p is equal to mass into velocity, mass of equivalent mass, and c speed of light equal to h nu by c. From this relation, mc equal to h nu by c equal to h over c by nu or h over lambda. Therefore, wavelength of a photon is given by h upon p, where p is its momentum. De Broglie said the same relation should be valid even for matter waves, because the nature loves symmetry and both matter and waves are assumed to have same nature. Therefore, for matter waves also, we should have lambda de Broglie equal to h over p or h over mv. Continuing with matter waves, let's now calculate the de Broglie wavelength associated with an electron accelerated by a potential difference v. For such an electron, the work done on electron will be E into V, because potential difference is work upon charge. And this work is converted into kinetic energy of the electron. So we have kinetic energy gained by electron equal to half mv square equal to E into capital V, which gives us expression for speed of the electron as 2EV upon m under root. Therefore, the wavelength or de Broglie wavelength h over p or h over mv can be calculated by using this expression for speed as h over root 2 me into 1 over root v. These being constant factors and their values are written here, we get lambda equal to 12.3 over root v angstroms. So if v is 54 volts, using this expression, lambda theoretically, the de Broglie wavelength theoretically, according to de Broglie relation, will be 1.66 angstrom. Now, to verify the hypothesis, Davison and Germer conducted an experiment. Since the wavelength is very small as compared to light, ordinary diffraction slits are not possible to be made. So Davison and German in their experiment made use of a nickel crystal. We know that in metals the atoms, they form well-defined arrangement, and hence there are well-defined planes of atoms. The gap between the planes act as very narrow slits. In Davison and German experimental setup, we have a filament heated by a low tension battery. On heating, this filament emits electrons, which are accelerated by positive potential applied to this anode. The anode has a very fine hole along its axis. This is called accelerating cum focusing anode. The accelerated electrons, they were made to fall on a nickel crystal. They were diffracted by nickel crystal, and the diffracted beam is steadied here by means of this collector. We can rotate this collector and find out the intensity or number of electrons diffracted through a particular angle phi. It was observed that the maxima occurs at an angle of 50 degree, phi equal to 50, leading us to the value of theta as 65 degree, because theta plus phi plus theta equal to 180 degree implies theta is equal to 65. Now, using this relation 2d sin theta equal to lambda for first order maxima in diffraction, we get lambda equal to 1.65 angstrom. We have used value of d, interatomic spacing between nickel atoms in the crystal, as 0.914 angstrom, and sin 65 is 0.906. The experimental value happens to be 1.65 angstrom. Since this value is in close agreement with theoretical value 1.66 angstrom, therefore de Broglie hypothesis stands justified. Now, what is the use of the study of matter waves? The matter waves, or the electrons as waves, they are used in electron microscopes, which have given us an insight into crystal structure, microbes, and viruses.